Hello students, welcome to the EPG Pathshala. I am Professor D. Velmurugan, former head of the department, Center of Advanced Study in Crystallography and Biophysics, University of Madras, Guindy Campus, Chennai 25. And I am at present working there as the University Grants Commission's Basic Scientific Research Faculty. Today, we are going to discuss about the module dealing with atomic scattering factor and such a factor of a Bragg reflection, and we are going to learn in depth about the electron density equations. All these come under the paper biocrystallography. So, students, let us see what we are going to learn in this module as the objectives. First of all, I am going to introduce you all to a term known as atomic scattering factor, which gives a contribution to the scattering from a single atom. Then I am going to relate these to another term called such a factor of a Bragg reflection. Then I am going to tell you what do you mean by a bottleneck in crystallography called phase problem. We are going to learn much about the direct methods, the mathematical or the probabilistic means of overcoming the phase problem, and I can very well say that the fathers of the mathematics for direct methods are none other than Professors Karl and Hoffman, who have been shared the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in the year 1985. And I'm going to introduce you to a term known as normalized Schacher factor, which deals with the direct methods, and this corresponds to a point atom model, and this assumption is made in the field of direct methods. I'm going to teach you in detail the electron density map, from which we get the atomic size as a electron density maxima. And I'm also going to teach you how to obtain the phase values for centrosymmetric and non-centrosymmetric cases. When X-rays are incident on the lattice planes, these X-rays interact with the electrons in the atoms and they deviate their paths. These diffracted rays from different planes produce diffraction maxima under certain conditions, and this condition is given by the famous Bragg's law, for which Nobel Prize was given to the Henry Bragg and Lawrence Bragg, the father and son. The law simply says that 2d sine theta equals n lambda. The 2d sine theta denotes the total path difference between the rays hitting the first plane and the second plane, whose perpendicular distance is d, and the angle of incidence of the ray with the plane is theta, and n is an integer, and of course lambda is the incident wavelength. So now, n we are told the order of diffraction, and lambda is the incident wavelength. This last states that the total path difference must be integral multiples of wavelength to produce a diffraction maximum, that's all. So two planes were there. So total path difference arising out of the path traveled by the first ray hitting the first plane and the second ray hitting the second plane in the diffraction pattern, that total path difference should be integral multiples of wavelength. Let us see in detail about the atomic scattering factor. So as seen already, there is an interaction between X-rays and electrons contained in atoms. And of course, the unit cell contains molecules and molecules contain atoms of different species. As there are different number of electrons in each atom, the diffracting power of each atom will not be the same. For example, if you take carbon, it has 6 electrons involved in the scattering process. If you take nitrogen, it has 7 electrons. If you take oxygen, it has 8 electrons. So, the outcome of the scattering will be more for oxygen compared to nitrogen, and the outcome of scattering for nitrogen will be more compared to carbon. This is what we mean. The ratio of the coherent amplitude of waves scattered by an atom to that of a single electron kept at that point is known as atomic scattering factor of atom. So this is a classical definition. This atomic scattering factor of jth atom is denoted by small letter f subscript j. The value of the atomic scattering factor is maximum at the center of the electron cloud and decreases exponentially as one moves away from this center. Let us see this in a graphical way to have a better understanding. Figure shows the variation of this atomic scattering factor with respect to sin theta by lambda. If you fix lambda, given lambda, then it tells you that as theta increases, there is an exponential decay type pattern. No? Look at the curves. Each curve starts from different point on the y-axis. And if you look at fluorine, the starting number is, let us say, 9. Carbon, starting number is 6. Hydrogen, starting number is 1. Actually, what it means is that when sin theta of lambda equals 0, all the electrons take part in this scattering, and that is nothing but your atomic number. So that is why carbon curve starts with 6 and hydrogen starts with 1, fluorine curve starts with 9. And when you increase the theta, it gradually falls off. So usually the higher angle reflections are those where theta has increased values. The higher angle reflection will always be lower intensities, but they have to be used in the refinement process. We already know that unit cell contains molecules. Will there be only one molecule or two molecules or three or four molecules? We don't know. In a unit cell, other than the parent molecule, whatever the molecules are there, these are known as symmetry related molecules. Why you call it symmetry related molecules? With respect to the first parent molecule, a shift of coordinates, a translation, rotation. So these things can bring the other molecules. The rotational symmetry, translation symmetry will make the other molecules. So if you want to finally identify a molecular structure, it is not needed to find the atomic positions of all the molecules. Given the parent molecule positions, we can generate the positions of the other molecules. So parent molecule position is the only one a crystallographer finds. The total number of atoms belong to all molecules in the unit cell. So this is conventionally denoted as capital N. And these atoms are positioned at little xj, little yj, little zj, where j equals to 1 to capital N. And these positions are called fractional coordinates of the jth atom. Why you specifically call it a fractional coordinates? Whenever these coordinates have a value 1, which means it touches the surface of the unit cell. If xj is 1, which means that a-axis is touched. If yj is 1, b-axis is touched. If zj is 1, c-axis is touched. Suppose these fractional coordinates are a bit higher than 1, that is 1.02 xj value, it means from the original unit cell, that atom has peeped into the other unit cell along the x-axis or the a direction. So that is what we mean. Generally, most atomic positions for a given molecule will lie within the unit cell, and it is only these positions we are finding using X-ray crystallography. As I told you in the beginning, once you know these parent positions xj, yj, zj, and by knowing the symmetric positions of the other molecules, we can get the position of the atoms in the various other molecules in the unit cell. What is the need? The need to find the position of other molecules is that during packing, we talk about intermolecular forces. So what are the forces between one molecule to another and so on, for which atomic positions of the all molecules constituting a unit cell should be known. Bragg intensities of diffractive X-rays from the various planes are the overall contribution of interaction of X-rays with all the atoms in the unit cell. The total number of atoms in the unit cell is denoted by capital N. Suppose you have 30 atoms per molecule and you have 4 molecules in the unit cell, then capital N will be 4 into 30, 120 atoms. So usually the number of molecules in the unit cell is denoted by capital Z. Now, the interactions of these molecules depend on the individual atomic scattering factors of different species of atoms and also on their positions or the fractional coordinates. The intensity of Bragg reflection HKL is proportional to square of the amplitude of Bragg, any intensity, sound intensity or light intensity, always intensity is proportional to square of the amplitude. So in X-ray case also, intensity I
of bracket frequency HKL is proportional to square of amplitude FHKL. This amplitude FHKL is known as Schachter factor amplitude. So, experiment gives you, diffraction experiment gives you only intensities from which, if you take square root, you can get only the Schachter factor amplitude. So, mod FHKL represents the Schachter factor amplitude of Bragg reflection and which is proportional to the square root of the experimentally available Bragg intensities as given by equation 3. Let us now go, what do you mean by Schachter factor of a Bragg reflection? A Bragg reflection is denoted HKL, where HKL are the integers, no, positive, negative or 0, which are called the Miller indices. Now, the definition of Bragg reflection or the contribution of Bragg reflection is nothing but Schachter factor. Schachter factor of Bragg reflection is denoted by equation 4, which is FHKL. Remember, there is no Schachter factor amplitude. Schachter factor amplitude is different from Schachter factor. FHKL, it is the overall summation of the individual atoms, each situated at a different fractional coordinate. So, FHKL equals summation equal to j equal to 1 to n fj times e power 2 pi I hxj plus kyj plus lzj, where xj, yj, zj are the fractional coordinates of jth atom, and these are the quantities one is interested in finally, the atomic positions. If you look at equation 4, in the exponent, there is an I coming. I means imaginary. So, which means that Schachter factor is not a real quantity. Yes, it is a complex quantity, which means that it has both amplitude and an angle called phase, which we will see in detail later. This Schachter factor is a contribution of diffraction to a given Bragg reflection from the contents of the unit cell. A unit cell contains molecules. Molecules are made up of atoms. So, what will be the contribution from all the atoms coming from all molecules in the unit cell? That is known as your Bragg intensity, which is again contributed by the Schachter factor. For determining the three-dimensional molecular structure, the three positions of each atom constituting the molecule should be known. Intramolecular features like bond length, bond angle, and torsion angle can be calculated from the knowledge of the atomic positions. If you know the positions of two atoms, then regular analytical geometry tells you how to find the distance between two atoms. Only thing is the fractional coordinates, you have to convert into crystallographic coordinates in some orthogonal coordinates in angstrom units. Then simple formula you can find to distance between two atoms. If it is three atoms, we have two bonds and one angle. If four atoms are connected, we talk about rotation about a bond called torsion angle. All these calculations are possible only if you have the knowledge of the atomic positions of every atom constituting the molecule. Knowing the molecular structure of the parent molecules in the unit cell and the space group symmetry, the position of other molecules can be calculated and intermolecular interaction can also be found. The earlier equation what you have seen contain, as I told you in the beginning, a quantity I, and hence we say the Schachter factor FHKL can be rewritten as amplitude FHKL times e power phi HKL, because this comes from the trigonometry. Any complex quantity has an amplitude and a phase in the exponent e power I phi, because e power I phi can be expanded trigonometrically as cos phi plus I sin phi, and if you multiply by mod FHKL, I'm going to show you in the next slide, these expansions. This FHKL becomes mod FHKL cos phi HKL plus I times mod FHKL sin phi HKL, which means such a factor has two parts, real part and imaginary part, that is the expansion of a complex number. This phi FHKL is called the phase of Bragg reflection, and the modulus or amplitude of FHKL is known as Schachter factor amplitude. But experiment gives you only Bragg intensities. If you take square root, we get only Schachter factor amplitude. But to get the structure, in addition to a knowledge of Schachter factor amplitude, one must have the phase of the Bragg reflection, which is not coming from diffraction experiment. This is known as the bottleneck phase problem in crystallography. So now later we are going to show you why phase is needed. What is the connection between phase and body growth structure determination? Let us go one by one. Here we see a graph denoting the real part and imaginary part. This is known conventionally in trigonometry as an organ diagram. So real part is x-axis, imaginary part is y-axis. The red arrow denotes the amplitude of the structure factor for reflection HKL. If it is for the inverse reflection called minus H minus K minus L, the real part A will remain same and the imaginary part will become minus B. So now FHKR is coming down. The angle subtended by FHKL is plus 5 in the anticlockwise direction, and the angle subtended by F minus H minus K minus L is minus 5. So that is the difference. So this is the organ diagram. So this tells you what do you mean by amplitude and what do you mean by phase.
Now let us know what is the need to know the phase of Bragg reflection, namely phi HKL. Like the intensity of Bragg reflection IHKL, every Bragg reflection HKL has a phase. But unfortunately, the diffraction experiment gives you only the intensities of 4000 to 5000 Bragg reflections, from which if you take square root, it is roughly proportional to the structure factor amplitude. That is what is given here, amplitude of FHKL. So experimental Bragg intensities lead only to the amplitude of Bragg reflection denoted by amplitude FHKL. Why am I very specific? Because there is one more term missing from experiment, that is your phase phi HKL of a Bragg reflection HKL. Unless you know both these amplitudes coming from intensities and the unknown value phase of HKL, phi HKL, we cannot calculate the electron density to find or to determine the atomic peaks, which are nothing but electron density maxima. In other words, the non-availability of phi HKL in equation 5 is a bottleneck in X-ray crystallography when one is interested in the three-dimensional structure determination, and this bottleneck is known as phase problem in crystallography. The aim in a single crystal diffraction is to determine the atomic sites or atomic positions. Every atom has three positions, X, Y, Z, which we call conventionally in crystallographic language as the fractional coordinates of atom J. And since atoms are surrounded by electrons, the electron density in the unit cell will be maximum only at those places called atomic sites, and at other places the electron density will be zero because atoms do not exist there. Hence, the calculation of the electron density is the easiest way of determining the atomic positions. But soon we are going to see that it is not so easy. The electron density of any atom in the unit cell at any point X, Y, Z in the unit cell is given by a Fourier synthesis or Fourier series. Rho of X, Y, Z equals 1 over V. V is the volume of the unit cell, which can be found once you know the unit cell parameters. And this is multiplied by a triple summation. Each summation is carried over 1 Miller index, HKL, running from minus infinity to infinity. Then FHKL e power minus 2 pi I HX plus KY plus LZ. This FHKL is known as the coefficient in the Fourier synthesis.
So now, because structure factor is a complex quantity, it can be written as an amplitude times an exponent containing a phase. So FHKL equals mod FHKL e power I phi HKL. Now, to look into the electron density equation already given, the electron density at any point X, Y, Z in the unit cell is simply represented by a Fourier synthesis. 1 over V, even though this represents a single summation, it means triple summation over the three Miller indices H, K, L, each running from minus infinity to infinity, mod FHKL times e power I phi HKL times e power minus 2 pi I HX plus KY plus LZ. So now, if electron density values at different points in the unit cell are known, then you just sort it out in the decreasing order, and topmost larger values of electron density will give you peak. So that is the convention. So at what points you have top values for rho? So these are the atomic size. But to do that, we have to compute the right hand side. Here the V denotes the volume of the unit cell. Once you know the unit cell constant like A, B, C, alpha, beta, gamma, V can be calculated. Modified scale, the right hand side comes from diffraction experiment. For every x, y, z, you can calculate the second exponent, e power minus 2 pi I hx plus ky plus lz. Only unknown quantity in equation 7 is the phase, phi hkl. So, right hand side cannot be known as long as you do not have any knowledge about the phase of black refraction. So, only phase is known along with the experimentally known amplitudes, one can calculate electron density at various points and the electron density maxima represent the atomic size. So, this is called the bottleneck in crystallography, namely unknown values of phi, which blocks one to calculate electron density maximum. So this is also called the phase problem in crystallography.
Let us now know some details about direct methods of overcoming the phase problem. In case of small molecules, phase problem, namely how to obtain the phases which are not available from diffraction experiment, this was overcome by the mathematical methods or the probabilistic methods known as direct methods. Two eminent scientists, Professor Jerome Karl and Professor Herbert Hofmann, shared the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in the year 1985 for their pioneering continuous contributions made in the field of direct methods from 1950s onwards. Even though they proved the applicability of the direct methods in obtaining phases or to overcome the phase problem, they have been subjected to severe criticism by the then physicists because of the assumptions they made in the field of direct methods, like a real crystal with continuous electron density is replaced by capital N non-vibrating point atoms and the electron density is always positive. So these objections have been severely criticized by them, even when these two people answered them, stating that it's only an assumption. Once you get a rough model, we can go to the reality and assume that instead of point atoms, we can consider them spherical atoms. Instead of non-vibrating atoms, you can give some vibration. Even then, they vehemently opposed the answer given by these two people for phase problem just because Hofmann was a mathematician and Karl was a chemist, and the physicists thought that they alone can give an answer to phase problem.
Direct methods proposed by Professors Karl and Hofmann have been used to overcome this problem. But they have some assumption that real molecule is made up of point atoms which are non-vibrating that way, which was objected by physicists. Okay, so that is why their solution was not accepted by physicists. And finally, the wife of Professor Jerome Karl, namely the peptide chemist Isabella Gall, took up the formula developed by these two people and proved in a dipeptide case how the molecular structure can be obtained using the formula developed by them called direct methods. Thereafter, the same group which objected this started writing computer program, and the first program came from University of York, England, and that was named as Multan. Now, in direct methods, we use a formula known as tangent formula. As the name significant, tangent means sine over cos. If you look at equation 8, numerator has a sine function, denominator has a cos function. If you look at the terms entering here, the formula, these are called E values. E values means normalized structure factor values. These correspond to point atom types. Your ordinary structure factor corresponds to spherical atoms, and E's correspond to point atoms. There is a formula connecting these two. From F, you can go to E, corresponding to point atom. Direct methods are based on non-vibrating point atoms. And also, they are based on the concept that electron density should be always positive. The probabilistic estimates of linear combination of phases are initially estimated, and they are refined using the tangent formula shown in 8 to obtain the single phases of black refraction. This is a famous tangent formula. Now let us go in deep. What do you mean by normalized structure factor? Since direct methods assume point atoms, which are non-vibrating, one has to convert the ordinary structure factor corresponding to a spherical atom to that corresponding to a point atom. The structure factor amplitude corresponding to point data model is called nominal such effect amplitude. And what is the relation between these two I already mentioned? That is given by equation 9. Mod EHKL equals mod FHKL divided by epsilon times square root of summation over little fj square, where this atomic scattering factor fj takes care of the thermal correction bj, which is obtained from Wilson plot. Fj equals fj 0 e power minus bj sin square theta by lambda square, which means that atoms do have thermal vibration, and the effect of thermal vibration is decrease the intensities or the decrease the atomic scattering factor. So that is given by this formula. So now this mod E is known as normally such effect amplitude, and the epsilon is a parameter which depends on the parity of diffractions and also on the crystal system. Bj is the thermal factor for small molecules. This every atom average value can be taken as 4 angstrom square.
Let us now look into the E-map. So what is an E-map? In a Fourier, we talk about the Fourier coefficient FHKL, the structure factor of a Bragg refraction HKL, which is made up of two components, amplitude part and a phase part. We know now FHKL is nothing but mod FHKL times e power I phi HKL. This phi HKL is the phase. Now, this mod FHKL corresponds to a spherical atom. But direct methods assume that we have, instead of spherical atoms, point atoms. So hence, we cannot use the same such a factor which corresponds to your spherical atom. So now mod EHKL corresponds to the such a factor contribution from the point atom, which has a relation to the such a factor contributed by a spherical atom. These two are related. And now, if you use mod EHKL in the Fourier series, that Fourier map is known as E-map. Assuming you got an answer for the phase problem, or you know the phase values from the direct methods proposed by Professors Hoffman and Karl, now we know both amplitude of the normalized structure factor mod EHKL and the phi HKL. So we can easily compute the E map, and hence atomic position can be roughly calculated. I'm telling rough because they have made some assumptions, non-vibrating point atoms.
Now let us see what will be the values of phases for centrosymmetric and non-centrosymmetric cases. So before this, we have to define what do you mean by centrosymmetric case and what do you mean by non-centrosymmetric case. For every atom in the unit cell at the fractional coordinate little xj, little yj, little zj, if there is an identical atom at minus xj, minus yj, minus zj, then this is called a centrosymmetric case. Otherwise, it is known as non-centrosymmetric case. In case of non-centrosymmetric, the phase of Bragg refraction HKL, phi HKL, can take any value between 0 to 2 pi, whereas in the case of centrosymmetry, phi HKL can have only two choices, 0 or pi. That is why we say that phase problem, that is the way to determine the phases, gets simplified in case of centrosymmetry, because instead of finding the whole range of phi values between 0 to 2 pi, now we have only two choices, 0 or pi for centrosymmetric case. Can you prove it geometrically? Yes, we can do it. It's a simple trigonometry. All of us know that e power I theta equals cos theta plus I sin theta, and e power minus I theta equals cos theta minus I sin theta. Now, go back and look at the classical expression for such a factor, FHKL, which was written as summation over little j running from 1 to capital N, the total number of atoms in the unit cell, fj times e power 2 pi I hxj plus kyj plus lzj. That exponent can be now expanded using the formula 9a to give you simply equation 10. If we look at equation 10, we have a real part, then with that is added an imaginary part. So we can simplify this as AHKL plus IBHKL. And if we rewrite FHKL, the complex quantity, as mod FHKL e power I phi HKL, and you expand that e power I phi HKL as cos phi HKL plus I sin phi HKL, we simply get equation 12. So now, the 11 and 12 for such a factor F of HKL are two means of writing the sum. Now, comparing all these equations, we get the value for AHKL and BHKL as summation equal to J equal to 1 to N FJ cos 2 pi HXJ plus KYJ plus LZJ, which is also equal to mod f hkl cos phi hkl, and b hkl equals summation little j 1 to n fj sin 2 pi hxj plus kyj plus ldj, which is also equal to mod f hkl sin phi hkl. This is 14. Now, the 14 contains sine part, 13 contains cos part, dividing one by other, we get the tangent part. Tan of phi hkl is bhkl by ahkl. So, this is it, like a tangent formula. In general, ahkl and bhkl, which are known as components or geometrical factors of structure factors, can have any value, because of which the phase phi hkl can have any value from 0 to 2 pi, which is happening in case of centrosymmetry. But if you look at the set of centrosymmetric case, a non-centrosymmetric case, phase can have value 0 to 2 pi, as A and B part can have any value. But look at the centrosymmetric case, the situation is different. What is the definition of centrosymmetric? For every point at xj, oj, zj, we have an identical point at minus xj, minus oj, minus zj. Therefore, in the structure factor for a centrosymmetric case, the summation from little j equal to 1 to n, total number of the unit atoms in the unit cell, that n can be split into two parts. N by 2 atoms with positive coordinates, n by 2 atoms with negative coordinates. Assuming this and with that understanding, we can easily write the structure factor expression as summation j equal to 1 to n over 2, fj is common, we write within bracket e power 2 pi I hxj plus kyj plus lzj plus e power 2 pi times h into minus xj plus k into minus yj plus l into minus zj, that minus can be taken outside, and that is written as e power minus 2 pi I hxj plus kyj plus lzj. So this is equation 16. So now, if you look at 16, it is of the form e power I theta plus e power minus I theta. So as per our earlier proof, e power I theta plus e power minus I theta gives 2 cos theta. Okay, so that is the way. So we get simply f hkl equals simply twice summation j equal to 1 by 2 n by 2 fj cos 2 pi into hxj plus kyj plus lzj. If you want to avoid the 2 here, the summation index up to n by 2, you replace it as n. That's all. So fhkl is simply j equal to 1 to n summation fj cos 2 pi times hxj plus kyj plus lzj, which is simply a part hkl. So in centrosymmetric case, the structure factor fhkl has only one component, which is the real component, namely ahkl. In general, fhkl is ahkl plus ibhkl, which means that in centrosymmetric case, bhkl part is absent or bhkl equal to 0. If you look at the general formula we derived for the tan phi hkl, which is bhkl by ahkl, now the formula becomes 0 over ahkl, which becomes 0. So whenever tan phi becomes 0, automatically phi has only two choices, 0 or pi. That is why we are telling that the phase problem becomes simplified in centrosymmetric case. Because compared to the non-centrosymmetric case where the phase can vary anywhere between 0 to 2 pi, as we have the existence of both A part and B part, in centric we have only A part. So B is becoming 0. So phase has only two choices.
So students, let us summarize what we have learned in this module. We now know that single crystal containing molecules diffracts X-rays. Bragg intensities of diffracted X-rays contain structure factor amplitude information only and no phase information. But electron density calculation requires both the amplitudes and phase of Bragg reflections. Non-availability of phases from experiment is known as phase problem in crystallography, and this problem has been beautifully tackled by the two pioneers of this direct methods, Professors Hoffman and Karl, who have been honored with the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in the year 1985. I had the good fortune of doing my postdoctoral work under the Nobel laureate Professor Hoffman. I have very great pleasure in explaining you all about the basics of these methods, which we'll cover in some of the modules. We also saw that in centrosymmetric structures, the phase problem gets simplified because it can take here only two values, either 0 or pi, instead of having any value 0 to 2 pi in case of non-centrosymmetric cases. Thank you.